The message that I have for you today is a simple subject, three words, but it's something that I find that so many of us do. And that message is living without thinking. Living without thinking. What I'd like to do today is read a scripture text from Romans the 12th chapter. Romans the 12th chapter and the first and second verse, but I want to read it from a translation that I referred to a few Sundays ago. That translation is called The Message. If you don't have this translation, of course, most of you probably do not. You can always access this translation by going online to BibleGateway.com. BibleGateway.com and read the biblical text in a whole lot of languages or translations. Okay? From one of the more recent translations or versions, actually, because it's already in English, from Romans the 12th chapter, verses 1 and 2, it says these words. In fact, I'm going to read it out of the traditional text, and then I'll read the text that inspired my message for today. Romans 12 and 1 and 2. Here's what it says. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Second verse says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How many of y'all have ever heard those verses before? If you grew up in the church any period of time, you've heard these verses. One more time, from the traditional text that we are most familiar with, it says, I beseech you, I beg you, brethren, I plead with you, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Second verse, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now I'd like to read the same thing out of the translation or the version called The Message. Here it is. Here's what I want you to do. God helping you. Take your everyday ordinary life. You're sleeping. You're eating. You're going to work. Your simple walk around life, and place it before God as an offering. That's some deep stuff, isn't it?
Yes.
How you sleep. Come on, who ever thought about that? Well, again, why do I have to place how I sleep before God as an offering? How I eat, what I eat, why do I have to place that before God as an offering? Going to work? Gotta go to work. Why does that need to be put before God as an offering? In other words, the whole context here is, brothers and sisters, understand that everything you think, say, or do ought to be a reflection of the presence of God in your life. Many of us Africans have become so preoccupied with information about Africa that we have forgotten about how to live a righteous life. Place your life before God as an offering, embracing what God does for you Check this out. This is how it goes on to say, embracing what God does for you is the best thing that you can do for him.
Yes.
Now the second verse is going to really blow your mind. I love how it says this. Second verse. Don't become so well adjusted to the culture that you are in. That's the message right there. Don't become so well adjusted to the culture that you are in that you fit into it without even thinking. Can't say it no plainer than that. Let me read that one more time. Don't become so well adjusted to the culture that you are in that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You will be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what God wants from you and quickly respond to it. Check it out now. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. Of course, after reading this same verse from the version called The Message, the subject came to me, living without thinking. Brothers and sisters, from the time we come out of our mother's womb, there is an agenda that we enter into. Believe it or not, the safest place for us was in our mother's womb. Some people often make a comical matter and say, when I came out and saw what was really going on around here, I was like, I want to go back. Let me go back up in there. You can't do that. Coming out of your mother's womb, you entered into this satanically inspired environment. And from the moment you come out of your mother's womb, you become a target of what I call social engineering. Yeah. Social engineering, so that you know, by definition, within the parameters of human psychology, social engineering is the science of determining, check this out, the science of determining and predicting human behavior by developing and implementing methods and programs to adjust human behavior in their relationships to other persons, groups, organizations, institutions, etc. The vehicles that are used to socially engineer us are, the first thing is called school. The second major entity that's used for social engineering is called the church. Believe it or not, and it's in this order, the next major entity that's used for social engineering is known as correctional facilities. I don't know why they call them correctional facilities, because they don't correct anything. The next entity that is known for social engineering is something called the military. The hospitals, and it goes on and on and on to your clubs and organizations. It's all about social engineering. They want to literally determine and predict how you're going to act. Today, I want to focus on social engineering in an area called religion. Brother Ray, how in the world can religion be used to socially engineer us? Again, the purpose of social engineering, brothers and sisters, is to determine and predict your behavior. So that means that all the social engineers have to do, all the social scientists have to do, all the programmers have to do is write down some stuff and tell you it's from God. And they control your life. Why? Because as the text says, we have become so well adjusted to this culture that we're in, that we fit into it without even thinking. I don't know if y'all can relate to what I'm about to say, but as I was riding here this morning, riding down the street, I'm looking at people on their way to church, people who are walking. And I saw some people dressed well. And I could look at them, and just by appearance, they look like they might be good people. With their little briefcases, with their books and their Bibles in their under their arm, on their way to church. There was a time when I looked at that and I said, isn't that wonderful? But today I looked at it and I said, that's so tragic. Is it tragic to go to church? No, that's not tragic. But as I looked at them, I could tell by the materials one guy I saw had him, he had some books and he was just hustling. He was just walking with his head bowed down, and I looked at him and I said, wow, on his way to be brainwashed some more, on his way to be indoctrinated some more, on his way to be programmed some more. Now, brothers and sisters, bear with me and understand why I say that, especially those who may be visiting with us today. Once your eyes come open, yes, sir, to the truth of how we have been hoodwinked, yes, with this religion given to us by our oppressor, once your eyes come open to it, you are able to readily see those who are still sleeping. Yes, who are still dead, like the little boy said in the sixth sense, I see dead people. But they don't know they're dead. That's a horrible feeling, brothers and sisters, to see people you care about, to see people you love, devoted and dedicated to something that is absolutely lifeless. They run to church every week to suck on a pacifier. Y'all missed that one. They get up, get dressed, put all this energy into how they look, making sure they got their tithes, to run to church to suck on a pacifier. I didn't say a milk bottle. I said a pacifier. You know what's really deep about it? When a baby cries because something in that infant wants nourishment, many parents throw a piece of rubber in that baby's mouth. Some babies fall for that. And they just go to sucking on it. Guess what, y'all? We do the same thing. They've thrown a religion in our mouth called Christianity, and they use it as a pacifier. They call a religion called Islam, they use it as a pacifier. They throw a religion in our mouth called Hebrewism, and we use it as a pacifier. And what's deep about it is because the information, the intellectual gratification we get from certain things and explanations, we think we're getting something. So we sit up in church. Amen. Sucking on what? Look at the person next to you, say a placebo.
Placebo.
For those who don't know what that is, that's a trick upon your mind, making you think something is that is not. We've been psychologically engineered to believe that certain books are God's word. In Christendom, we've been believing that the Bible is God's word. Yes, we have. Then, based on what we've been psychologically engineered to believe, we have the unmitigated audacity to say that we're the ones who's right and everybody else is wrong. We go through it all the time, people. I mean, how many times have you tried to share the little bit of information that you've received, and you go to share with people who have not taken the time to research or read what you're talking about, but they'll tell you that you done lost your mind. Child, you in a cult. You better get away from over there. We just heard testimony of this morning in the presentation. We never stop to ponder the reality that we've been programmed. Check this out, y'all. We have literally been programmed to divide and conquer ourselves. Yeah. Let me say it again. We have been programmed to divide and conquer ourselves. On the platform of our own ignorance. You don't believe what I believe. And the book that the oppressor gave me, because we don't say it like that. The book that the oppressor gave me say, how can we walk together unless we agree? Okay? Who programmed us to do that? We've been programmed to love a religion that is self-destructive. Now follow me, y'all, when I say the religion is self-destructive. And by the way, Christianity is on the demise, in case y'all didn't know that. Islam, believe it or not, is on the demise, in case you didn't know that. Judaism is on the demise, in case you didn't know that. Buddhism is on the demise, in case you didn't know that. And why is it on the demise? Because people are tired of religion. Everybody's tired of religion. People are starting to wake up and realize that wars are fought in the name of religion. Marriages fall apart in the name of religion. The divorce rate right now is higher in the continent of Africa than it has ever been throughout history. In Africa, they are getting over 3,000 divorces a day. Did y'all hear what I said? You know why? Because the white man has come into Africa with his Christianity. African cultures that have existed for 18, 19, 30,000 years, living healthy within their cultural environment. The white man comes and says, you can't live like this. If you want to be saved, If you want Jesus in your life, you got to divorce your wives, man. For you can only have one. And African cultures are being turned around in the name of Christianity. Yeah, buddy. Within the parameters of the Christian mind is the division of its own leading personalities. Now, I'm going to drop some stuff on you. You're going to blow your mind. How many got your Bibles? Because, see, you're going to need this information to set your people free. But you got to know it first. Let me drop that on you while I'm saying, let me say that again. Please don't go to try, please. Don't go try to set nobody free if you ain't free. Don't make that mistake. Please don't try to go talk about something that you don't know about. More damage has been done. Let me show you what I learned from Pastor Ray, and you got one sentence. Don't make that mistake. That's bad as a person who start taking karate and get in a street fight 3 weeks after they start taking karate. Right? They've learned just enough to get their behind with. Okay? From the paradigm of the biblical perspective, there is the incompatibility of Christianism versus Paulinism. Now, follow what I'm saying carefully. How many of y'all know some Christians? Let me see your hand. Or people who profess to be Christians. Every hand is up. I guarantee you, every last one of those people that you are referring to when you raised your hand, they ain't Christians. They don't know they're not Christian, but they're not Christians. They are Paulinists. They're Paulinians, not Christians. Paulinians. And if you ask them, you know, are you a Paulinian? No, what's that? I ain't no Paulinian. Are you a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Christian. But yet everything they believe is based in the teachings of a so-called guy named Paul and not Jesus. Did y'all hear me? I'm getting ready to go there with you now. Don't take more. Listen, follow what I'm saying. How many of y'all have ever heard of the doctrine of salvation? Yes. Salvation, yeah, right. Salvation as the doctrine didn't come from anything that Jesus taught, if Jesus had actually lived. Anything that quoted, nope, not at all. When it comes to salvation, everything we believe is what Paul said. When it comes to, in fact, it was Paul that said in Romans 10 and 9, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. That's Paul's writing. Jesus never said nothing like that. Or the so-called Jesus of the Bible never said nothing like that. Sanctification. Doctrine of sanctification all comes from the writings of Paul, the Pauline epistles. Glorification. That's that doctrine where folk get happy over the fact that they're already up in heaven. It says, you know, for those whom he called, he also did justify, justification, another one. And then who he justified, them he glorified. From Romans, the 8th chapter, Paul's writings. Justification. Nobody taught no mess like that until somebody named Paul came along. Y'all following me? Now, speaking from the parameter of the biblical perspective, Paul is the one who said y'all was justified. Paul is the one who said, no matter what you've done in your past, no matter what you've done in your life, it's all right. Just believe. And God wipes your slate clean. That, look at the person that said, Paul said that. Okay? Adoption. That is the doctrine that you don't really belong to God, but God's mercy reached down and snatched hold of you anyway. God, you've been adopted into the royal family of God. Paul's writings. Election. That means that God chose certain ones to be saved. For whom he called, that's the Greek word eklektos, where we get our English word elected from. And that concept is that God looked down on the whole earth and he picked out certain ones. By his grace, he picked out certain ones and left others to be lost. And people walk around with their chin up in the air talking about, I'm one of the elected, honey. Paul's writings. Y'all see this self-righteousness that comes from this myth? And then you got the unmitigated audacity to walk down the street and look at other people and look down on them. Instead of saying, if it wasn't for God's grace, I'd be in the same mess they're in. Predestination. Oh, that's Paul's teaching. Romans 8, 28, 29, 30, somewhere in there. It says, for whom he did foreknow, forgot about foreknowledge. Oh, man, I forgot about that one. That's Paul's teaching, the way as God knew everything you was going to ever do. He knew whether you was going to believe on him or not. And based on what he knew you were going to do, he already decided to save you. Which means in the mind of God, you already saved before you even, oh, come on, people. Now, I can say this because, y'all, I taught this mess for over 20 years. I mean, they trained me well. Now I see the mess that I caused among my own people. Predestination, that means that God has already decided what your end is going to be. He's already set your destiny. So don't worry about nothing. Look at the person nearest you and say, that's why we messed up. Because, see, we've been believing all this stuff. You know, I'm going to tell y'all the truth. I mean, here's what it does. Check out the subliminal programming here. If everything is already set and squared away, then what you need to do anything for? I mean, think about it. If God has already predestined you to be conformed to the image of his son who never existed. But you don't know that. So you're going to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. Hope I ain't talking too hard for somebody. Those of you who've been here, I know y'all can handle it, but I'm concerned about our guests today. Those who, you know, one day you, and, oh, child, it does not yet appear. What we shall be. But we know. Look at the person and say, you don't know Jack. We know that when he shall appear. What the rest of them say, y'all? We shall be like him. All right, you got it. We're going to be like him. And folk get excited about that because this is a Pauline message. Yes, yeah, buddy. Oh, I forgot about this one. Perseverance. The doctrine of perseverance. Now, anybody who's been to Bible college, y'all recognize all these terms I'm using. Perseverance is the teaching that, and it's taken from Philippians 1 and 6. Check out what it says. Out of this one verse, they built this doctrine from Paul's writing to the Philemon, for it says, being confident of this very thing, that he that hath begun a good work in you, who knows the rest of it? Why don't y'all know your Bibles? Will perform it. Thank you. Will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Now, what is that saying? That's saying you ain't got nothing to worry about. If God started a work in you, no matter how much you mess up, it's going to be all right because God's going to complete the work in you. You don't have to do it. God's going to do it. Y'all follow what I'm saying? That's called the assurance of the believer. In other words, that's the teaching that once you're saved, you're always saved. doctrine of atonement, which means that all your sins are covered under the blood. That's Paul's writing, 5th chapter Romans. Now, again, most people who say they're Christians are not Christians, because you don't follow the teachings of Jesus, you follow the teachings of Paul. Right. Now I'm speaking again as though Jesus, from the Gospels, if Jesus did exist. Now, let's deal with this thing. Let's deal with this thing for a moment. Let's look at Paul's lie. For those, now maybe this may not apply to some of you, have been delivered from this. Thank God, but most of your people have not. Right. So they need to see in their own Bible that Paul lied. Turn to Romans, the 3rd chapter, the 7th verse. Now I'm going to tell you what it says while you're looking for it. The so-called author called Paul actually says, if God is getting the glory out of the lie that I made up and taught y'all, why are you angry with me?
Again.
Let me say it again for y'all so you can see it. He's actually saying in this verse, if God is getting the glory out of the lie that I made up and taught to y'all, why are you upset with me? Now, can I get a witness? Who's looking at it? Somebody read it real loud and tell me what it said.
For if the truth of God hath more abounded
through my lie. Ray Hagins didn't write that. I didn't put that there. But it's one thing for certain, most church folk ain't never been shown this verse. If the truth of God hath abounded much more through my lie, what is it going to say?
Unto his glory. Also judged as a sinner.
Why are y'all judging me as a sinner? Y'all see it? Now that's enough right there. That one verse is plain as day. If Paul is the one that got all these doctrines that y'all believe in, if he's the writer of all these doctrines and he's telling you, I done lied to y'all. See, the disciples had a problem with Paul within the parameter of the biblical text, because historically, none of them existed. See, see how I got to talk to you? See how we got to talk here? From the basis of world history, none of these folk existed. But yet, we got this book that most of our people are enslaved. Here's the new shackles. Here's the new chains around your ankles, right here. Here's the shackle around your neck, right here. So since you still have this chain around your neck and around your ankles and around your wrist, I gotta go in here with the right key and set you free. You understand what I'm saying? Once you really understand the real agenda and the truth behind it all, I don't want to hurt nobody's feelings. You know, you probably place this in a place where you got some other paper. You understand? In case you run out. Did that make sense to you? I mean, once you really understand this thing, you understand what I'm saying, people? I don't mean no disrespect. I really don't. But you gotta understand what it is that's got us enslaved. Until you see the thing that's enslaving you. I'm your black brother. I ain't enslaving you. I'm trying to set you free. I was enslaved by the same thing till God opened my eyes And believe me, there's enough evidence right here in this itself to get your eyes open. Let me give you another example of what I'm talking about. Okay, turn to Galatians. Galatians, now these are questions you ask to set your people free. Y'all following what I'm saying? Galatians, the second chapter. Galatians, the second chapter. Now, based on what we have all been raised to believe, based on what we've all been taught. Now, y'all don't mind thinking with me today, do you? Huh? See, again, the message today is living without thinking. I guarantee y'all, if we had thought more, I wouldn't even have to stand up here and preach this kind of message. But we got so entrapped in something because we didn't think. Now I'm trying to get you to think, and you don't want to think. But you're going to have to think to be set free. In Galatians 2 and 7, now check out what it says. It says, but contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of what? Of the uncircumcision was committed unto me as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. Now look at the person next to you and say, that one verse, look at the person right next to you and say, that one verse, come on, tell them. It's talking about two different gospels. What are those gospels called in that verse? The gospel of the uncircumcision and the gospel of the circumcision. Right? Okay. Now, here's what I want you to do. We're talking about two people. Paul supposedly wrote this and Peter. Paul is supposedly saying that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me or given to me, but the gospel of the circumcision was given to Peter. Now, the question is, by who? Y'all follow what I'm saying? Who taught Peter? Come on, within the parameters of the way we've been taught, talk to me. Who was Peter's teacher? Jesus, right? No, not Paul. Peter was a disciple, wasn't he? Come on, Sunday school people, talk back to me. Peter was a disciple, wasn't he? In fact, when they came to arrest Jesus, based on what we've been taught, Peter got so angry, he reached and grabbed his sword and said, y'all ain't touching him. And cut off the man's ear. He was going for his head, but he got his ear. You follow what I'm saying? Peter was a follower of Jesus. Now, Jesus supposedly gave Peter the gospel of the circumcision based on what we just read. Can we go to school for a moment?
Yes.
Well, who gave this gospel to Paul? According to Paul's testimony, I was going down the Damascus Road. And a light shined out of heaven, and it was so bright I fell to the ground. And I said, who is it, Lord? And the voice spoke to me and said, I'm Jesus. Whom thou persecutest? According to Paul's words, it was Jesus that spoke to him. And when he went out into the desert, he talked to no flesh and blood. He only went to commune with Jesus. So the same Jesus that gave Peter the message of circumcision gave Paul the message of uncircumcision. Two different gospels coming from the same person. Notice the 8th verse. For he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the uncircumcision, the same person that worked in Peter worked mightily in me. Isn't that what it says? Well, we got a problem, y'all. Because Peter called Paul a crazy man. Right in the Bible. Let's go look at it. See, this is the information you need to have to set your people free. According to the Bible, Paul was a lunatic. Folk ain't gonna like this message. That's okay. Most folk don't like antibiotics. Really? Folk don't like castor oil, man. But it'll clean you out, won't it? Can I get a witness? I don't know, maybe your mama didn't do you like my mama did me. She said, here, boy, take this. That was some nasty stuff. But it got me straightened out. 2 Peter, the third chapter. Now, what book is this? Peter, right? Peter is supposedly, of course, not really, but they're attributing this book to Peter. So let's see what the author of this book got to say about Paul. 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, verse 15, 16 and 17. An account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation. Now notice what he says. He says, even as our beloved brother who? Paul. Now at least he called him a brother. At least he was diplomatic and referred to him as our beloved brother. But he goes on to say some heavy stuff here. Even as our beloved brother Paul also, now check how he says this, according to the wisdom given unto him. That's called diplomacy, y'all. Okay? Because in essence what he was saying is, I don't understand what that fool talking about. Okay? He knows what he's trying to say, but I don't know what he's trying to say. So I'm going to say diplomatically, according to the wisdom that's been given to him, he goes on to say, he's written unto you folk. Okay, now notice the next verse. As also in all his what? Epistles, meaning all of the writings of Paul, speaking in them of these things, check it out, in which are some things hard to be understood. So he's telling you here, in all of Paul's writings, he's saying stuff that don't make sense. He's saying stuff that we weren't taught. He's saying stuff that is against the truth. Now check out what it goes on to say. Which they that are unlearned and unstable rest. W-R-E-S-T, which means they twist it around, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. 17th verse. You therefore, beloved, seeing you know these things before, since you know that the man is crazy, beware. Y'all see it there? Beware lest you also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. This man, Peter, is actually warning the people about Paul. Now, this real tragedy is a preacher today will pull that verse up and say, this is what the Bible say about Hagins. I wasn't alive, y'all. He's talking about Paul. And then John even gets deeper into it. In 1 John 4, turn to it. Break it down. 1 John 4th chapter. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Now I know y'all heard this one. But try the spirits, or test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are going out into the world. And check this out. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. Now check out this thing, because it's going to blow your mind. If you look it up in the Greek, what it says is everyone who confesses that Jesus was a mere human being is of God. Oh. Everyone that confesses that Jesus was a mere human being is of God. Our brother here in the red sweat and the red, he was with us this morning. Do you have that passage? 1 John, the fourth chapter. Not the Gospel of John now. 1 John, at the back of the Bible. Right. How does it read out of your version? What does it say?
What verse?
That's the second verse, fourth chapter.
And you can't know which ones come from God. His spirit says that Jesus Christ had a truly human body.
That is. Just his human nature. The New International Version says he was only a mere human being. Now, what's so special about that? Because you Paulinians want to say that he was God. Y'all follow what I'm saying? Oh, okay, I'm getting too deep now. Getting too deep. Brothers and sisters, we have to heal ourselves. The best way for us to heal ourselves is start thinking. Share this information with your loved ones. They don't want to think, but I guarantee you, when you show it to them in their Bible, see, if you don't show it to them in their Bible, you ain't got no effect on them. Because see, we've been programmed. If it ain't in here, hey, glory, it's got to be in the book. So go to the book. Go in their book and show them. Let them see for themselves. What tickles me is how they say, that's what it say. Let me go get my Bible, see if it say that. See, your Bible, that's your Bible, see? So they got to go get, the, I want to see that in my Bible. Fine, let's get your Bible. Like we done wrote our own Bible or something. The reason why we messed up family is because we've gotten hung up in religious indoctrination instead of spirituality. You were raised and told what to think, not how to think. We were taught to fall in love with tradition instead of truth. Let's see, I meant to turn to Mark. Mark, the seventh chapter. Let us see what it says in their own Bible. Mark, the seventh chapter. Sixth verse. He answered and said unto them, well hath Isaiah prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written. This people honoreth me what? With their lips. But their heart is far from me. Y'all hear what I'm saying? This is how you can tell religious people. Religious people go through the form of religiosity. They got it all here in their mouth. You know? Oh, they know just how to say what they want to say and make you really believe that they're deep with God. You know, this is when they call, you know, and they talk about people like the pastor. They never call the pastor a man of God. The pastor becomes the man of God. The man of God. Not the man of God, the man of God. Those are the people that's real deep. Those are the ones where every time they open their mouth, it's the Lord.
Right.
Hallelujah. They take on a vernacular about themselves that's not even them.
Right.
They ain't like that at home. They don't talk like that at home. They go to almost cussing at home. Y'all know I'm telling the truth. They do that for us when they come to church. When they come through the door, they take on that atmosphere. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Tradition. Notice what it says. You honor me with your lips, but your heart is from me. Notice the seventh verse. Howbeit, in vain do they worship me. Y'all see it there? Why is their worship in vain? Why? It goes on to say, teaching for doctrines what Roman Catholic bishops created and made up. Of course, it doesn't say Roman Catholic bishops here. It says the commandments of men. Like 318 Roman Catholic bishops at the Nicene Council. Who sat down and decided what should be taught as religion. And now we have taught it. Notice the eighth verse. It says, now this is some deep stuff. It says, for laying aside the commandment of God, you hold on to what? You see it there, don't you? Tradition. I've seen it. Ninth verse. Full well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition. Tradition is more important in churches than truth is. People will kill you over tradition, brother. Don't mess with our tradition, brother. This is how we've been doing it since I was a child. Never entered our mind that maybe you've been wrong since you was a child. Thank you, Elder Lucas, for how you said that today. Sister, you know you wasn't raised like that. And she said, I know I wasn't raised like that. But when truth comes to light, I say when truth comes to the power, after a while, power got to go to the truth. We have more of an appreciation for hypocrisy instead of honesty because we've been raised not to think. I've never in my life, people, never have I in my life seen so much hypocrisy as I have in today, as I see nowadays. Instead of honesty, you know you ain't all that. You know you ain't. You know you ain't victorious today. Look at the person next to you and say, ain't nobody victorious all the time. Nobody. But you don't want folk to know that you're not victorious today. So you become hypocritical. You manifest a character trait about yourself that's not really you at the time. Okay? See, your testimony can't be a testimony of defeat. You can't say, I'm not doing too good right now. Can't say that. Because see, then you're doubting. You understand? So you got folk walking around mastering being hypocrites. And we love damnation more than salvation. Mm-hmm. We get happy when we find out that people are experiencing being damned. Something's wrong with that picture. You ain't supposed to rejoice over somebody's downfall. So what? They did you wrong. Big deal. Don't get happy over the fact that they're down. Because trust me, if you get happy over somebody being down, yours is coming around. Sooner than you think it is. You understand what I'm saying? Our prayer should always be, God help all of us. What was that movie where the guy said, God bless America and no place else? Y'all remember that? Head of state, yeah, right? Go on, Frizzella. A lot of people got that mentality. God bless us and nobody else. God bless me and my family and nobody else. Don't bless them. Look at the person nearest you and say, don't think like that. The principles of righteousness in my heart says the energy that you put out is coming back to you. Okay? Don't ever forget that. I'm not responsible for what you do to me. But I am responsible for what I do to you. Yeah, buddy. Family, start thinking. Exercise intellectual vigilance as Africans in everything that you encounter. And help your family to do the same. Ashe.
If you're interested in including Dr. Hagins as your next keynote speaker or guest lecturer, just give us a call at the number you see on your screen, or you may write us at the address that you see on our screen. Thank you, and we look forward to hearing from you soon. Hotel.